so I wrote for you the meaning of the word block for everyone. B-L-O-C, without the K. Block means an alliance to promote a common goal. It's an alliance of governments to promote a common goal. But it also could be an alliance of people to promote a common goal. It is very commonly used to say a political bloc, an alliance of parties, political parties to promote a common goal. Maybe raise minimum wage, maybe impose tariffs, maybe protect an industry, whatever that might be. Or it could be, you know, just an alliance of groups, of parties, of people, of governments to promote a common goal. The goal will be a political goal or an economic goal. These are the two main goals that they would promote. Okay. Well, some of you may form a bloc for whatever reason. Okay. All right. So back to Bretton Woods. Bretton Woods lasted a long time. Bretton Woods was from the very beginning, just like the Genoa conference system, just like the gold exchange standard before that, the new gold exchange standard had a flaw, a major flaw, a built-in flaw. It was based on a currency before. There were two key currencies, the British pound and the dollar. Now the USD was the key currency, and the key currency enjoys a privilege. The privilege of printing money and others using it as reserves. The privilege allows for an extended trade deficits to accumulate and allows for an extended balance of reserves accumulated in foreign countries and for the country to benefit for a while until the system collapses. So the system as it was designed was similar to the gold exchange standard, flawed from the beginning and doomed to collapse from the beginning. But it took a whole lot longer to do that. Now why? The reason is that the British pound, the key currency, started as overvalued, and the problems began to accumulate quickly. Now, the US dollar started as undervalued. This provided a double advantage for the US dollar. They could now export, so the US, the undervaluation caused major industrial growth. It was driven by export growth. In general, resulted in economic growth. Now, what is important to remember on the gold exchange standard, that British economy suffered horribly because of the overvaluation of the pound. Well, now the American economy benefited tremendously from the undervaluation of the dollar. So this was truly great for America. And America exported to Germany and to France and to Japan and to the rest of the world and enjoyed phenomenal, all of these, growth and prosperity. And as a result of the growth and prosperity, it turned socialist. It built in social security. It provided for free medical system. Medicare. It provided retirements and also, in other words, the government began spending.
When you feel rich and prosperous, government began spending.
And there was a flaw. The government could early on, because it had very undervalued currency, the government could inflate, benefit tremendously, meaning cause a phenomenal boom, where stock market going up, bond market going up, real estate going up, salaries going up, okay, employment going up, everything's going up, and everything is good, and everything's great, and everything feels great, so that they caused a phenomenal boom. And it was the problem tempting. They kept on doing this for 10 or 15 years, and from 1946 to about 1960, they ran the system hot, meaning they inflated sufficiently where the dollar from undervalued through, from undervalued through inflation, the dollar became overvalued. Now, why is this important? We just studied the previous hour. Overvalued means what? Overvalued means expensive, means suddenly U.S. exports were down. In other words, overvalued currency meant uncompetitive exports, so the exports was down. Imports, as in cheap imports from Japan, were up. And you have trade deficits. And when you have a trade deficit, you pay those deficits with dollars. So the benefit is just print dollars and give them to the Germans or give them to the Japanese for their Toyotas. Okay? So this resulted in what's called dollar accumulation. Dollar accumulation, or rising reserves of foreign countries. In other words, Germans had a whole lot more dollars, French had a whole lot more dollars, the Japanese and everybody else, British had a lot more dollars, so suddenly everybody's got a lot of dollars, okay? And they inflated the money supply so much that there was many times more dollars than underlying gold, okay? So, now the question is, you're Germany, what do you do? You say, wow, we have so many dollars, we don't need them, we don't use them anymore. We might as well go and get some gold for it. Well, eventually, we call this it's got a name. You know, you don't trust the currency anymore, and we call it a run. It was a dollar run. Now, this has two names. It's called run on the dollar, in the sense you don't trust the dollar anymore, or, which is the same thing, it was a run on gold, led by France. But as soon as France and other countries began to convert their excess dollars into gold, there was suddenly a rush by everybody to convert to gold. Hey, we got so many more dollars than gold, we might as well rush, and if we're the first, we get all the gold, and the others one, we leave with worthless pieces of paper. Which is exactly what happened. Those that rushed first got the gold, and the others at some point in 1971, the U.S. will be on August 15th, said that the dollar is no more convertible to gold. In other words, the US dollar will not honor its promises to pay gold for dollars, right? Promises were made to be broken, right? In other words, they said, we're not giving gold anymore. And Nixon called it only a temporary phenomenon, but the temporary now can last them for good 45 years or so. So, the system was flawed. Eventually, their undervaluation in the inflation in the 1950s by about 1960 was overvalued. And then it took about 10 years or so, 7 or 8 years, for the whole system to collapse and unravel. Let me see if I missed anything from this very important stage. Oh, this undervaluation essentially meant that there was a there's a dollar shortage. When it's undervalued, there's a dollar shortage. Americans are exporting a lot, but importing very little before that, when it's undervalued. Importing that. So Germans couldn't get a lot of dollars in the early days. French couldn't get a lot of dollars. So there's a dollar shortage. So suddenly, because there was a dollar shortage, everybody wanted to get dollars and keep dollars and accumulate the dollars. Now, here, you got the opposite. When the currency is overvalued, you get, what do you get? Dollar surplus. These countries got dollar surpluses, and these dollar surpluses, once you got too much money, get to worry about it, that the money would be devalued. So before it devalues, the dollar surplus was the driver of the run on gold, or run on the dollar, which is, in this case, the same thing, is a rush to convert dollars to gold and get them out of the US. All right, so this is why the system collapsed, which completely collapsed in 1971, but there is a transition period. There is a transition period from 1968 until 1971. For us, this transition period is called unraveling, with one or two L, depending whether you spell it British or American. So this is the unraveling of Bretton Woods. Bretton Woods is the unraveling. You know what means unravel? It begins slowly to, you know, lose its structure and everything else. So this is a transition period. It is not very important, except for one thing, which I will explain now. First of all, 1968, there was a crisis of confidence. That's page 103. Alright, page 103. It was a crisis of confidence. And as they began to exchange gold, and again, German citizens, they could convert their Deutschmarks to gold, sorry, to dollars, they can convert them to gold. What happened was the crisis of confidence was on two levels. The one level was the people who begin to get too many dollars and get a little bit, you know, hey, what are we going to do with those dollars? And again, it was something else. Remember, if you're a German, German marks, Deutschmarks, are based on dollars. As the U.S. government ran huge trade deficits against Germany, German government had an increase 2-3 times supply of dollars. Because their Deutschmark was based on the dollar, they had to increase 2-3 times the supply of Deutschmark. Now the German citizens look and say, geez, there's so much money everywhere, I might as well convert to gold. So people rushed and had a run on gold, and separately, governments, both the German but mostly the French government, had a run on gold. And this, suddenly, the Germans people, they were, you know, governments, you gotta negotiate with the one government, the other. Well, if you're a person, just go on the market and buy gold. And soon enough, there was what's known as a two-tier system. The two-tier gold system or gold price system, gold market. Two-tier gold market. The two-tier means that there are two levels, two different groups. Okay? The one was the market for the people, and the price of gold just kept going up and up and up. Okay? And then it was for governments. And the price of gold was constant. The government said very simple, well, let's do the following. We can allow the free market to drive the price of gold to 50, 70, whatever, $100, $200, $2,000 or $1 million, we don't care. We, the governments, will stick to the old system of exchanging the dollars for gold, all for gold, only for governments. All right. Well, what's going on? If this price of gold goes up, suddenly you're a supplier of gold, you're not going to supply to the government, you're going to supply to the free market. Okay? So now the free market begins to absorb a lot of gold on a lot higher prices, and with a lot higher price, and at the same time here a fixed price, you get a shortage of gold. And suddenly people say, hey, we gotta buy gold, we gotta invest in gold. Well, once shortage of gold occurs, or people begin to perceive a shortage of gold, suddenly there's a crisis of confidence. And this is what I was explaining over here. Suddenly, this resulted in run on gold. The governments tried to make up for the problem by separating the gold market in two, and it simply didn't work because you had two markets with one good, one commodity with two different prices. It can't possibly work. There will never be a fresh supply here, and all the supply will go over here. So here you're going to have enough supply, here you're going to develop shortages. So shortages of gold to the government and government sector. Now if you're a government, you cannot, you know, buy gold. So suddenly, you're the Austrian government, you can, or German government, you can go to the American government and get your gold, or you can go on the free market at a much higher price and buy gold. Again, if $35 one ounce equal, let's make it like this, $1.35 on the government market, but on the free market is $70, and you know that the US government keeps printing and printing and printing, and you know that 70 is going to turn into 80, and it's going to turn into 100, you try hard to get your gold at 35 from the US government, but if you can't do it, you might as well go on the free market and start buying at 70, because 70 is sure better than 80 a year from now, it's sure going to be better than 100. So this means now that the system begins to unravel. You institute a new mechanism, which is not the free market, which is government control. But again, it doesn't work. Again, it can't possibly work. Again, it's destined to failure. Let's see what else we got. Oh, so suddenly the US government comes with a brand new solution.
This is getting weird.
Special drawing rights known as SDR. So what the US government tried to do is say, okay, well guys, we're gonna have an international reserve. And the international reserve will be an international currency called special drawing rights. So you give us some of your dollars, and with some of ours, we're gonna create this fake currency, which they properly called paper gold, to be the source of reserves. And that worked for just a few months until governments again realized that it was just, they called it, you know, gold, but it's actually on paper. You can't get the real gold. So this system was trying to be instituted. It also failed for the same reason. You're not getting the real thing. You're just getting something which is not really backed by anybody, has no asset behind it, has no, it's just an empty promise by nobody. Okay, it's not even the US government. In the US dollar, at least it's a promise by the US government, or at least they said, okay, we're gonna pay by $35 if we think you're, you know, a good, let's say, in our American alliance. All right, so basically, this whole thing, by 1971, as the people saw and realized, government saw and realized, the French were the main driver where they just said, well, give us the gold, give us the gold. They send ships full of dollars, demanding ships back with gold. And eventually, the US kept paying and kept paying and kept paying. In other words, it was drawing down the gold reserves. And once the United States lost more than 50% of its gold, and literally lost them in a year, almost 50% in 1 year, the US government and 7-1 basically said, no, we're not gonna pay anymore. All right? So, in 1971, now, this transition is what? Phase? This transition is phase 6. Alright, now, it's important for two things, well, one main thing. You can't have for one asset, for the same asset, two different prices, two different markets, and make it work, and keep it working. Yes, you can make it work for a short while, until the gap in the discrepancy, opens wide. So, now coming to the question, how and why is this important today? I'm switching now the topic. Is important today for a simple reason. China. China has a currency. It's called yuan. Also known as RMB, and the Chinese yuan is just one currency, just like gold is one thing, one asset, but it's got a onshore exchange rate and an offshore exchange rate. The onshore exchange rate Strait means mainland China. So, if you're in a mainland China, inside China, Beijing, and whatever, you can go and you have a particular exchange rate, which is like it's called the central bank fix, and you can exchange your yuan currency, your RMB, you can exchange the dollars. But they also have an offshore, which could be traded anywhere in the world, but the main market is in Hong Kong. And there is usually, currently, about 5 cent difference. So, let's say 592. 692 will be on the one market, and 687 will be on the other market. Okay. So, usually the Hong Kong market is considered the free market, and usually the onshore market is considered the regulated market. And as soon as the price gap opens to more than 10 cents, suddenly weird things happen in the Chinese financial and banking system. So it's important to understand that. So the Chinese have figured out that they gotta keep it within 5 cents range. So the offshore Hong Kong is the leading price because it's the free price, and it tells you where the trend is going. And widening of this gap tells you that there is some fundamental problem inside the Chinese currency. So this difference here is an indicator. Indicator, same as barometer, or if you like, thermometer of what we call currency stress. Currency stress. Alright? So, when you see these two tier pricing systems, you know something's wrong. Example will be, we read it in class, Venezuela. When the government fixed the Venezuelan currency at one exchange rate, and then there is the black market or the free market, which has a very different gap. The bigger percentage gap tells you that there are some fundamental currency stress and currency problems. So this is an early indicator of currency trouble. All right, let's move on to next. 71, 70, what is it, 3? Is it 73? Yeah. All right, okay, they have here another tiny little phase 7. Now, this phase 6 is barely 2 or 3 years. Phase 7 is from
the end of Bretton Woods.
Yes, the end of Bretton Woods, correct, from 1971 August, as I already wrote up here. 15, so August 15, 1971 to December again, 1971. So this is August, September, October, November, December. Just 5 months. Tiny little short. So I wrote this here. Phase 6 is a transition period. Phase 7 is also a transition. This is the literal collapse. The president comes in August and says, well, we can't exchange your dollars anymore. Now, you got to understand what this really means. The economic meaning of not exchanging dollars for gold, the economic meaning interpretation is that the U.S. went bankrupt. This was essentially the president going on TV and declaring bankruptcy without calling it bankruptcy, because bankruptcy means, you know, it implies shame and disgrace. But presidents don't do that. They don't shame themselves or their own country. All right, phone. Hey. Oh. All right, transition period, okay? So, they went, it's called off gold, meaning dollar is not convertible to gold, there's absolutely nothing. Now, this is the first time when America is not on gold. And this is the first time when the world is not on gold. So this is the beginning of the true, genuine monetary chaos. Except for the Swiss. They're kind of like on gold, but it's not really discussed. There are some controls and other stuff. Swiss is a tiny little country, so it is not in any way, it's not even 1% of the global economy. So Switzerland has got a little else, a little something different going on, but it is not important in any way. So now, US was the last country that was on gold, and now even the US is on gold. From here begins the true, genuine monetary chaos. From here on, you got now financial crisis and countries going bankrupt and all the monetary chaos. So that's phase 7, short, very easy. Let's go to phase 8. In phase 8, I think it's called the Smithsonian. The Smithsonian.
Agreement.
Now, this is again transition. They tried to rebuild something similar to Bretton Woods, but not really. They tried to build something similar to the Genoa Conference, but again, not really. So what's this transition? Let me read it, because that's, you know, it's very hazy in my memory. Nixon came and said, oh, this is the greatest monetary agreement in the history of the world. We have all agreed to keep our currencies fixed. To keep our currencies fixed, meaning fixed exchange rates, okay, but without gold, and better, without backing. So what does it mean? Oh, we're gonna keep dollar to pound, we're gonna keep German mark to the French franc, we're gonna keep everything fixed to everything else without an anchor, without conversion to gold, without conversion to anything. Well, who's going to keep the exchange rate fixed? Who's going to keep the exchange rate fixed? Well, the short answer is government. Okay, government. But to keep the exchange rate fixed, this means that the government's got to expend reserves. But what is the reserve? If it's not gold. And remember, up until yesterday, or up until August, it was dollar, it's not dollar. So the government will support it, but there's gold is not in the system. The whole world is off gold. So there's gold is not a reserve, and the dollar.
No, not the dollar.
And the dollar. I mean, the dollar was a reserve for 40 years, well, 37 years, and not anymore because there was too much of it. So the problem was that the system you're supposed to keep the fixed rate, the exchange rate fixed, but without reserves. Well, how is that going to happen? Well, it requires a genius for the answer. Short answer is it can't happen. It's impossible to happen. It can't work. It won't work. And government soon find it out. So the government is supposed to keep the exchange rate fixed,
Well, what's the reserve? Now, nothing's the reserve. So how is the government going to manage the exchange rate? It's not clear. But there is another bigger problem. Governments, as we studied, that was already chapter like 4, have an inherent interest for their own benefits and for their banking system benefits to inflate. So governments are supposed to hold the exchange rate fixed, but instead all the governments did was inflate. So one government inflated
like the German 1%,
the British government rather bankrupt
at 4%.
French were even worse, whatever that was. So governments began to inflate at different rates. Well, if you keep exchange rates fixed, the only way to keep the exchange rate fixed is to keep the money supply of the one country divided to be fixed to the money supply of the other country. In other words, the ratios of two money supplies must be the same. Is that fairly clear? You want to keep the exchange rate fixed? If the one money supply, the ratio must be constant. Money supply for currency A, the ratio of money supply to currency B must be constant, as in fixed. But if one money supply grows faster and the other supply grows slower, we already studied and we already learned that was the gold outflow mechanism. In this case, it's going to be the currency outflow mechanism. The currency that grows faster, the country will experience outflow, just like Britain experienced outflow before. And the mechanism will soon collapse the system. And this is exactly what happened. How much longer? How much longer? How much this transition phase period lasted? Don't look at me, you gotta look in there. You gotta look in the book. The textbook, what does it say? How long did it last?
1971 to 1976.
Oh, from December 71. From December 71 to February 73. Okay. Well, that's how many months? 14? Let's call it 14. In other words, it was a short transition period. So, going back to my stuff over here, the gold standard lasted a good 100 years. The gold exchange standard lasted, let's call it roughly 10 or so years, maybe less than 10. The new gold standard Bretton Woods lasted, better call it 1971. That's how we like to call it. 45 to 71 is how many? 37? 37. So we have three primary periods. Okay. And we have three primary periods, and out of 9, we have about 5 or 6 transition periods. All right, so I'm going to be finishing next time, meaning next week. Let me just introduce what's happening next. So the system collapses, and now it's phase 9. Now, this book was written early, so I'll explain next time the anyone? What does it mean? I wrote it already twice.
price. What does it mean, fluctuating currencies?
Bottom line, monetary chaos.
It's the same old story. Currency blocks without the K, right? Trading blocks, tariffs. 1970s, okay, fluctuating currencies, 1973 onward. One major thing was currency wars. Two. Remember, we already had currency wars, okay? Well, maybe even three. Again, depends on how currency wars. So, you have now the classical dirty clothes. Now, I'll finish here today only to explain what is a dirty float, and so it can go eat and right. What is a dirty float? It is the following. The currency can go up and then can go down and go down and go down and go down. And suppose that's the trend. What is the government going to do? It's going to introduce what's called kind of like a snake. They're going to go and they will see, let's say that there's a downtrend, and they'll try to keep the currency so that when it hits the upper channel, they'll intervene and try to keep it here, okay? When they see it falling, they'll let it fall. But when it hits the lower border, they'll try and support it. In other words, dirty float means the government allows for the currency to float, but not too much, not too extreme. So over here, they'll keep it more like this, okay? And then over here. So they'll try to, it's just smoothing. It's called smoothing. They'll simply make the transition again. They can keep maybe even a lateral a little bit. Then when it goes to here, may not go, okay? So they'll try to, it still flows, but it's not within as wide range. So they'll try to narrow the range into, it's called reduce volatility. In other words, the government will allow the free exchange rate except when the movement is extreme one way or the other. They'll intervene temporarily to dampen the extreme. And I'll next time continue with the modern financial system. Let's call it from 1976 to 2016. See you right in the book. All right.
Lunchtime.